day, once more they gather at the crystal as the first sun climbs to its peak. For this is the way of the Skeksis. As they ravage the land, so too they learn to draw new life from the sun. Today, once more, they will replenish themselves, cheat death again, through the power of their source, their treasure, their fate, the dark crystal.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special report.
This is Cheapseat Reviews.
Hello, and thank you for listening to Cheapseat Reviews, the podcast that explores the Hollywood film industry for the greater good.
The greater good.
This is episode 200 and something, 261, I think.
Wow.
Yes, 261.
I don't know why I'm continuously surprised that we just keep going.
We keep going.
But I every time you say the number, I am continuously amazed.
Yeah, no, that's fair. And and so far, Libsyn hasn't deemed it necessary to kick us off. And because people still listen...
Somehow, some way,
we're going to keep doing this show until something happens. Episode 261, and tonight we're talking about The Dark Crystal, the 1982 Jim Henson and Frank Oz directed movie, The Dark Crystal, which if you've seen on Netflix recently, they just produced a little mini series. It's like a prequel.
Is it on yet, or is it still?
I think it's on. What month are we in?
We're in August.
Yeah, it's coming up soon.
Okay. It looked pretty cool, the previews.
Yeah.
In terms of the puppetry and the interesting.
Yeah, and I'm glad that they. Yeah, and I'm glad that it looks like they're sticking with it. So.
Yeah.
With the puppetry and things, not just going full CGI. So yeah, The Dark Crystal. I am Sean Allred. All right, so bear with me. I hope this works out the way I want it to. I am Sean Allred, and joining me tonight is Andrew. Jimison. I didn't think there was a way to successfully represent that without just playing the clip. So, Andrew, every time you make a valid point tonight, I'm just going to play. There you go.
Very good.
And Sam. Vector.
I'm glad you got my traveling glee club there.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate when you have to fill out paperwork because that's really hard to.
Oh dear,
yeah.
And Sean, yeah. I've slept for the past 48, 72 hours, so I didn't come up with one for you. But if I did, it would have to do something with the Beatles crushing you to death.
Oh, that's fine. Speaking of those Beatle things, I was reading that those suits weighed so much that the actors inside them could only wear them for 5 minutes at a time.
Oh, my gosh.
They were so heavy. They'd have to take them off and put them on these stands. And then when they were ready to film, they did run in action, do the bit, and then, you know, break.
Yeah, I guess they'd be really heavy. I mean, they're huge.
They looked really massive. Yeah, they looked really heavy.
But I thought they looked really cool.
Oh, they were one of the coolest parts of the movie, I thought, visually. When I worked at Scarewinds, which is the local theme park here, we do a scary thing. I've put on a couple of those costumes.
Yeah.
I mean, they're not that low to the ground. The ones that we have are usually like 8.5 feet, 9 feet tall.
Yeah.
Those things are heavy. I can't imagine what the things that those guys were wearing.
Do they use those in the ice show too?
No, we didn't do that. We didn't do a Halloween ice show. So, anyway, okay. I mean, I know the joke that you're trying to do, and no one will understand. But no, we didn't do an ice Halloween ice show. So this is that movie. This is 1982's The Dark Crystal. Had either one of you seen this before?
Actually, no, never. I thought I had. But I apparently the Labyrinth and this I've mixed up.
Oh sure.
So I've seen the Labyrinth. I have not seen this.
I had never seen it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So first
but
time.
I had seen the what are they called?
The Skeksis. Skeksis. Yeah.
The Skeksis. I had seen them before in the movie The Village.
Not quite, but yeah. Yeah, it's actually kind of a cross between the Skeksis and the Beetle
people.
That's
you know, I never thought of that, but I think Andrew's right.
I think you are right.
But you know, there is one thing that I'm dying to know.
Oh.
And I think Andrew will help me out here.
Okay.
I have no idea what I watched. And I would love to find out from Andrew what exactly this movie was supposed to be about.
Oh, well, I can tell you that. On another planet.
And okay, then that makes sense. All right, thank you.
Yeah, there you go.
That's all you needed to know.
On another planet in the distant past. So this is
not quite
the same way Star Wars starts out.
Yeah, not quite a long, long time ago. It's just a long time ago.
Right. A Gelfling embarks on a quest to find the missing shard of the magic crystal and so restore order to his world.
So let me get this straight. So a small-ish, unimposing, unmagical, unimpressive creature must take a thing, journey across a perilous land, and put it back in another thing to make the world safe.
That's what she said. Yeah.
So I feel like we've seen that before. Somewhere. I'm not sure where. No, that's okay. Even the Lord of the Rings version is not totally original. It's just an original way of showing that story. And that's what this is. It's the same story. We're just going to tell it in a kind of a very creative.
You got a MacGuffin there. Yeah.
Yeah, you definitely. But I mean, you can't get more of a MacGuffin than she literally has it in a box and she just throws it on the floor. I mean, could you imagine, like, Gandalf is like, oh, I've got this collection of rings. One of them is the Great Ring. Don't know which one it is. I'm just going to throw it on the ground, and if any one of you disappears when you put it on, that's the ring. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. This movie. I'm going to jump ahead only because I'm highly I'm not intoxicated. What am I, Kimberly?
You're medicated?
Medicated. Thank you. I'm highly medicated. I hated this movie.
Okay.
I did not like this movie. I could not stand it. And in fact, Kimberly and I were watching it last night, and I don't know how I tricked her into watching it with me. But I was sitting here, and I've been on some pretty heavy pain meds.
If Kimberly's going to keep participating, we have to give her a credit.
Those are your primary feat.
Yeah, and I, at one point, turned to my lovely wife and said, I think I'm having an acid trip, because between the main meds and the visuals that were on the pain meds and the visuals that were on the screen, I was so confused on what was reality for a second that it was just, what the heck was going on? The voice acting in this movie is horrible. It's horrible. The direction, you know, I love me some Jim Henson. He's a great guy. But I think the direction was horrible in this movie. There's so many times the characters have their backs to the camera. You have no idea what's going on. Each creature has you know, they have all these little grunting sounds that make no sense. And it was beautiful to look at. The puppetry kept me amazed, but you can only go so far looking at puppets before you realize how stupid this thing is.
Yeah. I will say that I'm kind of in the same boat as you. I thought it was, there were some things that really bothered me. The voice acting was one, even though the main character is voiced by Jim Henson.
Nope.
Yeah.
Oh, no?
No.
Nope.
Oh, he just did the puppetry.
They just did the puppetry.
Oh, gotcha. Okay. But the voice acting bothered me. But what I did notice, and I think what I've noticed about every Jim Henson production or movie, and that I just appreciated when I saw this one, is that in every single scene, there's something. Even if it's, you know, like the scene when they're out on the boat on the pond or river or whatever that is, they're doing a camera pan across the landscape, and there's a little puppet mouse just, you know, meandering. Mm-hmm. In every single scene, there's something that is moving, some sort of puppet. And I came to appreciate it a little bit more after seeing this.
I didn't honestly have to expect to step in here to be the one that defends the movie a little bit. but here's the difference. I have seen this before. I had watched this as a child. So now I've probably not seen it. I'm 37. So I probably haven't seen it in 28 years.
Did it scare you as a child?
Some of it, yes. Some of it, no. And you have to, and the reason why I think this hit really bad for Sam, partially because he was under medication. But the other part is you're a 40-year-old dude. This movie was made for children. Have you seen Coraline, Sam?
I've started watching Coraline.
But you know what Coraline is, right? It's literally Neil Gaiman said, I want to write a horror film for my 7-year-old. And he did. And that's what Coraline is. And Jim Henson and Frank Oz, they wanted to create a movie that was kind of scary because it's okay for kids to experience that emotion.
And it's the 80s, for God's sake. Think of Never Ending Story, for God's sake.
Yes, there's a lot of moments. Yeah, you're right. The 80s has a lot of kind of these little scary moments. So it's okay to be a little scared. Yeah. So as a kid, did it scare me? There were probably some moments that scared me. The Skeksis are, they're supposed to be gross, and you know, they're supposed to represent the bad of us, right? I mean, they're obviously a whatever you want to call it. It's not a morality tale. I can't think of what my word either. Good gracious! But
alliteration? No.
No. What's the other one? It's a metaphor. They're metaphors, right? For the worst in us, and of course the mystics are, you know, the good, the virtuous, the seeking knowledge. Even though they don't really do any magic except sing.
And disappear when the bad guys disappear.
Well, I mean, it's because that's part of you. When one of you dies, the other dies.
Yeah.
So
it's kind of the personification of good and evil.
It really is.
I mean, yeah. It literally the yin and yang.
Yeah, exactly. So the movie, I think, tells the story nicely. You know, it's a simple story. There's nothing complicated about it. The stuff that I don't like are similar to what you don't like, Sam. But like, even when you mentioned like, they have their backs to us. Well, that's because that's a human in a costume, and they need that person to run across a field to go pick up a thing. You know, like, or we need them climbing up a thing or jumping off a rock. So that's a little person inside a suit. That's Deep Roy or one of the other guys, or Warwick Davis, or somebody inside a suit. So, like, I understand why they couldn't show their face because you couldn't.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's obvious. Yeah. But, you know, in terms of stage front, I think there was some setups that were just not done real well. When he goes into the little witch's lair, there's several times where both of them are facing away from the camera when they don't really need to be.
Yeah, and I think. I didn't notice it when I was watching. So to me, my brain was probably just saying they needed to. There's a reason why, for the puppetry.
It probably had to do with just the set setup. They couldn't, because they have to puppet these things.
Yeah.
They couldn't get around like they would normally get around with live action.
I have to say, though, I was impressed by the different strategies that they had to use to do these puppets.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Because the puppets were impressive.
Yeah, I'm sure that at times there were puppeteers underwater or, you know, just in these really odd situations to do the puppetry.
And even like the stilt walking bat cat things that they ride on, I mean, that's obviously a dude on stilts with a fake puppet on its back, but it still looked kind of cool, and they were kind of neat looking animals. And to me, the whole movie is just a showcase of how creative these guys are.
Yeah.
I mean, there was nothing even that stupid dog ball thing. Like, you wanted to kick it every time it screamed at you, but it was kind of neat because it rolled. It was like a little fuzzy BB-8.
Yeah.
It bothered me that it never stopped barking, though.
No, I mean, like, you're not wrong. It's
you had
well, to and that had to do there. The sound. Just the sound design was just bad.
And I don't know why it is like that in the 80s. I don't know how Star Wars got it right and so many others got it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, fake lightning is just piercing.
Yeah.
And the noise when the crystal is shooting your face and you're getting the essence. Like, when I watched the essence part, for whatever reason, that was a moment. It kicked like a flashback of, oh, this scared me as a kid. I remember that specifically scaring me as a kid. Like, oh, my gosh, they could take out part of your body and turn it into a liquid that somebody else drinks. Like, that scared me a little bit as a kid. And I remember that emotion kind of kicked back on me. It was kind of funny. But, like, that noise is awful. It's piercing.
Yes.
I mean, I'm glad I didn't watch this on my good headphones. I watched it on the TV with my soundbar. And that was still painful.
Yeah.
So I don't know how so many movies in the 80s got it right and so many got it wrong. I don't understand. Mm-hmm. You know, like you look at like The Last Starfighter or Star Wars or the Star Treks. I mean, they do it fine. But then you get a movie like this where it's like, good Lord, what are you doing?
It's like it's muffled or something, too. It's just...
And it's too tinny. And it's very high-pitched. And it's...
Yeah.
It's,
or even the narrator. I was having a hard time understanding the narrator over the music.
Oh, interesting.
At times.
Yeah. That might have been the drugs.
Yeah.
That's true, too. Maybe he wasn't talking. Maybe it was just...
That was just your internal voice. Why am I talking so loud in my head? Oh, wait, that's Spider-Man.
Exactly.
The other stuff I will say this about the movie.
Can I say this? I did, you know, this is one of those movies that should never be seen in HD. And I was actually fairly impressed at the lack of problems that came out in HD. The only time I noticed anything was some string holding up the dark crystal. In some of the first scenes in terms of what I could see on my television, where it would have been hidden if it wasn't in HD.
Yeah, on film and VHS, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, you know, that stuff you forgive. I mean, you're just like,
yeah, it's a product. Oh, yeah.
And it's
they had to do it. How else could they have done it?
Yeah, so. I mean, it's a product of both the time and the way they wanted to show their movie.
Yeah.
So, like, any things like that, like when the Gelflings hold hands, like, their hands look like little plastic nubs. And but I didn't care, you know. And honestly, I like the idea they have this their dream share. It's like, oh, we're going to get backstory on you in a kind of interesting and creative way so that we don't have to just sit here and listen to you tell me your backstory. You know?
Yeah, but at the same time, I was confused as to what was happening. Again, because of the pain meds, I'm like, wait, what? Is there so many things happening at once?
Yeah.
I couldn't understand what was going on.
Yeah, I was tracking along. I was like, oh, yeah, she was a kid. He was a kid. They were both hunted because of the prophecy. And they, they found shelter. The only thing that, honestly, one of the few things that kind of annoyed me is our hero is kind of useless.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like,
in a lot of ways. Yeah.
Like if you take the Lord of the Rings analogy, all right, so you've got your three dudes. You got Aragorn, Legolas, and Gimli, and they each have a skill set. And then you got the four hobbits, and even the four hobbits, they all have their different skill sets, right? I mean, Frodo's might just be simple bravery. You know, Sam is loyalty, Merry is cleverness, and Pippin is lucky or something. I don't know. But you know what I'm saying? But in this movie, Kira, she literally has wings, so she can sort of glide and fly. She can talk to animals, right?
Yeah.
What does he have? At one point, he uses his flute to make the crystal glow. So I thought, ooh, this is a magical power. This is going to come back later in the movie. Nope. He just plays with the Ewoks in the thing after the Death Star has been blown up, and then, like, I thought that was going to be a thing that mattered, but
yeah,
I guess not. So anyway, He was really good at hiding and then jumping and catching a crystal.
And talking out loud. Or his mind
monologue.
Talking.
He had a lot of monologue. Yeah, a lot of monologue. Yeah.
And but honestly, I don't know how else they would do that other than lots of exposition.
And I thought for a majority of this movie that he was voiced by Matthew Broderick.
Yeah?
It sounded like Matthew Broderick to me the whole time. I don't know why, he just did. I mean, I know it wasn't, but...
This was before Ferris Bueller, wasn't it?
82, this would have been War Games. Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought it was him too for a while.
Yeah, Jim Henson, let's see, I got to find, it's so weird, because you have the performer and then you have the voice.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I'm trying to find the Gelfling voice. Jin was voiced by Stephen Garlick, who...
Poor guy has some breath problems.
Maybe. He hasn't done anything since 1992. He retired in 92.
Maybe he died.
No, he's still alive.
Oh, okay.
He was in a couple episodes of the Doctor Who in 83. So he's done a bunch of stuff. Nice. He just hasn't done stuff in a while. But I thought he sounded just like... Lisa Maxwell was Kira. Both of these two people have their IMDb photos are from this movie. She's still acting. She was she's still acting. Good for her. Mostly stuff on in England. So anyway. I no one else I recognize.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's okay. The narrator was Joseph O'Connor.
Joseph O'Connor.
He did die in 01. Let's see. I'm trying to think if there's anything I would recognize him from. I don't recognize anything in this. So, anyway, that's fine.
Yeah.
I thought the voice acting was fine. It didn't bother me. I mean, there were some parts
I
where
do.
It was kind of whatever, but it didn't bother me. I thought, I don't know. The annoying lady with the eyes, she cracked me up. Not gonna lie, she made me laugh.
She made me wonder that when these people that are making the puppets, do they like have people in mind when they make these puppets? Because you know, I mean, there's a look to some of them, and you think, man, I wonder if that is like a kind of a caricature of someone they know.
Yeah.
Right.
That could be. I didn't actually take many notes on this movie, and not because I was in such love with it that I didn't think there was anything wrong with it. There wasn't much to talk about because
it was landscape.
Yeah, you know, there was a lot.
I would almost appreciate this movie more as a dreamscape without the story. Don't talk, just kind of show. I would have been happy with.
Yeah, I think you'd have gotten bored pretty quickly after that, though.
Yeah.
You have to have a story. Really, the only few notes I wrote were like, the very first thing I wrote was, a small, humble, unassuring creature must return a thing to save the world. Sounds kind of familiar. And then I said, feels like this movie is showing off Frank Oz and Henson's imagination. I said, then, so does the essence not work? Like, it made his face look good, but then his hand got all wrinkly again, and then he got mad, the emperor, the new emperor. Which, by the way, choosing an emperor, you know, off of a physical...
Let me hit this rock.
Off of physical strength, that's such a trope, by the way. Yeah. That's a trope. Yeah. And then I wrote, this is my only really long note. One dies and then the other dies. I get that. They telegraphed that pretty early on that they're connected. One gets hurt and the other gets hurt. But what other senses do they share? You know what I'm saying? Like, if one of
like
them...
If one takes a leak, does the other one shake?
Yeah. I mean, I honestly, like part of the joke where I was going to go was, like, if one takes a nice big poo, does the other one go, like, oh, man. That's
good.
I felt such relief now, you know? Or, you know, like, one of them eats a big meal, and he's like, oh, wow, I'm not hungry anymore. I'm kind of full, or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like, or is it only bad stuff? I don't know. It's just kind of funny. The other thing, too, and I've mentioned this on the show hundreds of times, my problem when movies have the bad guy is a, like in Zootopia, like the little mouse is the head of the mob. Like, that would never work, right? I know it's a joke for the movie, but it wouldn't work. So, like, how are these things in charge? They're unassuming. They're slow. They're awkward. I feel like people should be able to get away from them easy enough to, like, not allow them to be in power. I don't know. Just,
yeah.
It just seems kind of random. But I guess if they have the Beetle people.
I wondered that. But then I just assumed that it was just because the puppeteer couldn't move any faster.
I mean, that's probably true, too.
Mm-hmm.
And then I mentioned that. So really, I've actually gone over all my notes, honestly. But I still kind of had a good time with it. I mean, there were some times I was a little bored, because again, it's the same thing, right? It's remember that stupid Space Hunter movie that we watched, Space Hunter and the Forbidden Zone.
Mm-hmm.
This reminds me of that movie in that everything's the same. We get into a new scene, so we get to a new place. We think we're okay. Problem: they run away. Right, so like,
yeah.
he has the mission. He goes to the place. He gets the crystal. Then the things show up. He runs away. He goes into the woods. He finds Kira. Gets stuck. She saves him. They have to run away. Now they're on the boat. Here come the bats. They're scared. They run away. Then they go to the place. They hang out. They party. Then the things come, and then they run away. And then they get to the front. And then there's a thing. And then they save their friends. And then they run away. I mean, that's the whole movie. And then the end is he gets the thing and stabs the crystal. So it just, the movie was beautiful. It was really beautiful. Mm-hmm. But it was
well done, yeah.
But after very 30 repetitive. Minutes, you know the movie. So
it could have been a 45-minute movie and just as effective.
Well, it would have been only an hour if they would have cut out all the beauty shots of their landscape and all the little critters mm-hmm. moving. And
every time the guy said,
Yeah, I do like in the movie though that you like stop doing that. That actually kind of made me laugh. Like, oh, even the dude that lives with you is annoyed by that stupid noise that you keep making. He just walks by.
Something that I noticed, and again, I started thinking about other movies that has puppetry.
Yeah,
but specifically Jim Henson movies.
Yeah,
and. I just was thinking back to childhood, to Sesame Street, and all of these puppets do the same thing. And it's some sort of, maybe you're trained as a puppeteer to do this, but when they're talking, and I know our listeners can't see my hand, but when they're talking, they are kind of standing still. And then when they move, they start to like bounce violently up and down when they're walking.
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking if they... I don't know if they ever studied themselves as they, doing certain things. I'm sure they probably filmed it and then watched it to kind of study how the puppet act, or, how the puppet looked. Was seen and looked as compared to real people and real movement. But I don't know. It just made me think, man, all of them shake violently when they walk. It's like they all have.
It's like the Kermit the Frog. When he has to go anywhere, he kind of he shimmies out of the scene,
flails his arms, and yeah.
Well, yeah, because it makes you think like, how are these people walking? Like when they take a step, are they bending like 6 inches down the knee? You're not wrong, but probably what happened is when they were originally doing these things, and you would just glide your arm, it probably made them look like they were floating.
Yeah,
and so they decided it looks. More normal for them to bounce like they're all on moon shoes than to float. Because like we see him bouncing, even in that violent bounce, we know what they're doing. They're walking. They're simulating the walk.
Right.
And we know that. But again, if they just glided around, we'd be like, oh my gosh, are these guys all on Segways? Like, what's happening? So I get it. It's just funny. Yeah. I actually had never even thought about that, Andrew, until you mentioned it. So Andrew made a point. So
Good job, Andrew.
Yeah.
That's the first time in 100 episodes of
it. Oh, that's not true at all. Okay. I don't. The only other trope I wrote down is I should have told you earlier trope. When the old man's dying and he's like, "Oh, I should have told you this long ago." Like, yeah.
Yeah, probably. Just,
yeah. I don't.
That would have been helpful.
It's kind of important.
Yeah.
Right?
Why didn't you tell me he was my father? Well, I didn't want to hurt your feelings or something. I don't know. All right. So we ready for some clips? I didn't get very many, but I got a few. So here we go.
I hope this totally shows why we hate the sound in this movie.
A little bit. Some of it does. I don't know. Here's 20 seconds of this.
Another great conjunction coming up. Anything could happen. The whole world might burn up. End of Augur. Better have your shard before that, Gelfling. Now, ask what the great conjunction is. What's the great conjunction?
And then the movie went to a really weird place after this. I don't really know if you guys heard it. Sam, you might have been on medication. It kind of got weird. So when he asks, when she says, ask me what it is, and he does, it got a little weird.
What's the great conjunction?
Conjunction, junction. What's your function?
Yeah, okay.
And it was very strange. I mean, like, we were in a puppets and all of a sudden we're in a cartoon and like learning about letters and words, and it was very strange.
Nice.
That's kudos on that one.
Had to, man. They kept talking about conjunction. That's all I could think about was conjunction.
I kept thinking, you know, she's got this one eye and I'm thinking conjunctivitis. And how that would affect this poor witch with one eye.
If you don't know what that reference was, please go Google Conjunction Junction.
Schoolhouse Rock. Or go back to the 80s and live.
Yeah, Schoolhouse Rock was awesome. I grew up on that stuff. So, anyway, this was kind of interesting.
That looks just like the shard. What does it mean?
And what are those funny marks?
Oh, this is all writing.
What's writing?
Words that stay. My master taught me.
I mean, doesn't it kind of sound like Matthew Broderick trying to do a British accent?
My words got stuck in the wall.
Maybe he was dictating.
And they stay there.
They stay in the wall.
I mean, I guess that's his other
superpowers. Let's all get high on marijuana and make this movie.
Maybe that's his superpowers, that he has knowledge, I guess. And then this is the only one I got. Other one I got. My last one is what I'm trying to say.
I don't have wings.
Of course not. You're a boy.
There you go.
Yeah.
Boys don't have wings, silly. They have a penis.
That's right.
And now for some more bad news.
And ready? That's how they fly.
I kind of mentioned kinda this
like
earlier.
Like Thor's hammer. You just kind of whip it around and helicopter your way out.
So I bought Endgame on.
I'm sorry, I just got what you said.
I bought Endgame and I've watched it. And tomorrow after my doctor's appointment, I'm going to watch it again with the director's commentary on this time.
Oh, nice.
And one thing that was interesting that I didn't pick up on when I saw it in the theater was that when Cap goes back, he goes back with Thor's hammer. And it didn't occur to me until this time watching it that he had to put the hammer back.
Because
Thor in that universe would need his hammer. In that timeline, he's going to need his hammer. So that's why he gave it. He took it back.
Yeah, somebody, I guess it was my cousin or my niece. Yeah, my niece was saying the other day that the reason that in some of the earlier movies when Thor puts his hand out, that it takes a few minutes for Mjolnir to get there because it's not there. Cap hadn't returned it yet. I thought, well, that's kind of
that doesn't work.
Reaching, but okay.
No, I did read this dumb thing on Looper. It's a site or whatever they do. Anyway, they did like this whole long thing about why Black Panther is the first one to come through the portal. And I thought
I saw that article, but I didn't read it.
Well, it's dumb. It's the obvious. I mean, they spend a lot of words to basically say, well, because he was in Wakanda, where most of everyone else was, and since he's the king, he gets to go first.
Oh, that's dumb.
I mean, it's kind of dumb. And honestly, what the directors wanted to do is they wanted Anthony Mackie to be the first one through because he's the first one. They always knew that he wanted to be the first one to communicate. on your left. They wanted the joke on your left, right?
Yeah.
And then that's when, and then you know, King T'Challa comes in first with his sister and his warrior lady. And in the moment, when you're first seeing it, you're like, well, where's Falcon? But it kind of makes sense because he's the king and he gets to go through whatever. Honestly, when I watched it in the theater, I didn't care. You know, like I didn't care. I just was like, oh, here it comes. It's about to go down. So now watching it on video at home, I still love that movie a lot, and it's wonderful. But honestly, the final battle scene, because Infinity War gave us so many great up close battle scenes with all of the characters, I had forgotten that you don't get that in Endgame. You get such a big broad with very few individual fighting moments happening.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, other than the three, when Thor, Iron Man, and Cap take on Thanos at the beginning of the fight, the rest is very quick cut and then just trying to get the glove from point A to point B. Whereas in Infinity War, you get the seven or eight of them all attacking Thanos individually, and it's kind of, I think, better.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Because you get to see,
I agree.
You get to see everyone's individual skill set, Doctor Strange and Spider-Man.
And what they bring to the battle against Thor.
Right.
Thanos.
Yeah, an individual. Whereas in this one, I mean, you know, Doctor Strange is stuck holding up water. And, like, you don't get to see Wong fight, and like, so anyway, I know it's kind of a nitpicky thing, but when I watched it again, I was like, oh, man, I kind of miss all the individualness, you know? So, anyway. That's
I would love an hour-long battle scene where it's just showing all these other guys fighting the other guys.
No, I mean, like, if they came out with an extended version where there is 20 more minutes of that, I'd be all over it. Because I want to see Ant-Man doing stuff. All you see him do is punch the big flying thing one time, and then that's kind of it. He's done. Let me see more of Thor fighting, because you hardly see him fight at all.
Yeah.
You know, give me Rocket and some more of that stuff. So anyway, it's fine. Sorry. I knew I was going to tangent at some point tonight, but I didn't know I was going to do it actually on that movie, because when you're on your back for a week, you watch a lot of TV and a lot of movies.
Yeah.
And I've watched a lot of movies this week. My wife and I watched Passengers. We watched Rampage. We watched The Meg. The Meg was
you
actually
didn't see The Meg.
The Meg was kind of fun. I'm not gonna
lie. Wasn't that a fun little movie?
It was kind of fun.
Yeah.
I mean, he basically punches a shark in the face. I mean, Jason Statham basically punches it in the eye, actually.
Yeah.
Anyway, we watched that.
It's fun.
We also watched Night School. That was pretty funny too, though, the Kevin Hart movie. Anyway, yeah. So trivia. Gosh, I forgot that's what we're doing. Trivia. Early drafts of the. Actually, I didn't even read the first one. Jim Henson's plan with the film was to get back into the darkness of original Brothers Grimm fairy tales. He felt that children liked the idea of being scared and that this was a healthy emotion for them to deal with. So that, I kind of mentioned that earlier. Early drafts of the script featured Jin and Kira traveling through the underworld, where they encountered a race of underground mining creatures. This concept was later integrated into Fraggle Rock.
You know,
including the musical opening.
When we started watching this, I almost sent you guys a picture of one of the characters from Fraggle Rock, because it reminded me so much of it at the beginning.
Right?
Yeah.
Yep.
We have a channel in our over there on the TV that has a bunch of old cartoons, and I've sat and watched a couple of episodes of Fraggle Rock with my kids, and they're unimpressed. But anyway, it's fine. But my son loves, my 6-year-old son loves the Looney Tunes, the old Tom and Jerry cartoons.
Yeah,
not Looney Tunes, but the Tom and Jerry. There's a channel, I think Boomerang just does, you know, between like 5 and 6, it's like an hour block of Tom and Jerry cartoons. He loves it, and I don't mind letting him watch it. You know,
yeah.
People had all these issues where they were super violent. Yeah, they're violent, but there's violence on TV anyway. So, yeah. You know.
It's cartoon violence, for God's sake.
It's very cartoon violence. Yeah. I mean, at this age, I'd rather him watch that stuff than some of the other stuff. Anyway. At the time it was made, it was hailed as the only live-action film in which a human character makes no appearance. With the exception of some wide shots of the Gelflings, it would have been the first live-action film where no human actors appeared. So that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
And then this film was banned in several Islamic countries due to the content that was deemed sacrilegious. Every Arabic dubbed and Farsi dubbed copy was destroyed by censors.
Wow.
That actually makes
sense. Like, what exactly was...
Yeah.
I don't know. I didn't go into it. This movie did make money. Which is kind of cool. I think I saw that it almost didn't get to the cough button in time.
Yeah.
It was a budget of $15 million, and I think it made like $130
million.
Oh, wow. So for 1982, this movie made a lot of money.
Yeah, it's not bad.
And did pretty well, again, for 1982. I mean, there were some other pretty substantial movies it was going up against in 1982, but it did well, and I'm glad it did. So, all right, here we go.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
We decided for our top three, we are going to do something like puppets, right? Movies with the puppets in it. Because why not? This movie is nothing but that. So, yeah.
Nothing but puppets.
Nothing but puppets. I think that's the name of our episode. Andrew.
Okay. Is that a euphemism?
I don't think so.
Because of where the hand goes when you...
That's what I used to play in high school.
Nothing but B-U-T-T puppets?
Yeah, because none of them actually have a butt.
Well, they don't have feet, but they sure do walk very violently.
They need some orthopedic shoes.
I like to tell people that if they piss me off, I'm going to turn them into a puppet.
Sounds awful.
Because it makes them think. They have to stop and go, wait. I think he's saying he's going to shove his arm up my anus or my mouth.
Or maybe just a stick, puppet. Like Jose Jalapeno on a stick.
Yeah, on a stick. Yeah.
All right, Andrew.
Okay. So number three is going to be Ghostbusters. And,
oh, nice.
In Ghostbusters, we have these dog-type creatures that were puppets.
Okay.
And some of the ghosts as well were puppets. Slimer.
I thought that was all just... the dogs were just stop motion, weren't they? Oh, no, there's a couple of scenes where they're
there's a couple puppet scenes.
Yeah, yep. You're right. They're not moving, like Zool is petting them on the head or something. That's a suit with a dude's hand in it or something. You're right.
And then number two is going to be Star Wars.
Which one?
Empire.
Okay.
And then number one is going to be Saw.
Oh, okay. Saw. Well, the doll. The weird, creepy-looking doll thing.
Is he in the first one?
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember it at all. We did that for this show. I don't remember the doll at all. Weird.
Want to play a game?
Yeah. Maybe it was in the... Was it just like in the video, the scary video that you saw?
Yeah, it was just in the video. Yeah.
Okay, I couldn't remember.
Yeah.
I just remember thinking, God, that guy was on the floor a long time. That would be so painful.
Yeah.
Anyway. Sam.
All right. My number three is harkens back to the 80s on Little Shop of Horrors. With the... a plant.
Yep.
My number two is, I just put Star Wars, all of them except the prequels where they ruined it by not having puppets.
There's not a puppet in Star Wars, A New Hope. Well, I guess
there is. Is there not?
I mean, I guess maybe there's something in the cantina scene. I guess those are probably some puppets.
Yeah.
I was always thinking specifically of Yoda.
Yeah. My number one is Jurassic Park.
Yeah, the little... The little egg raptor thing is a puppet, yep.
Well, no, the raptors in the kitchen are puppets.
Oh, that's right, yep.
Yep.
Are they puppets?
Like,
are they...
They're the most amazing puppets you'll ever see. When you actually see the raptors without the skin on and how the people crawl in them and move them around. It's amazing.
I'll have to check that out sometime. That is so cool.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, can't fault you for actually getting Jurassic Park in there appropriately.
I fit it in.
Yeah. I'm sure there's probably a Star Trek like TOS episode that has that kind of thing.
What about all those little things that kept reproducing? The Trouble with Tribbles.
Those are puppets, but I mean, those are basically, puppets is not even the right word. They're probably just like little balls of fur with vibrators in them to make them move.
Oh. Yeah. Ooh.
Which I know Andrew's all knowing about.
some people have expertise, I'm just saying.
Yeah. And with that, I say. There you go. I don't think about it. I don't know if it's a puppet. I mean, it's so in Wrath of Khan, which we watched for the show, the little thing that goes in his ear is it's like a gummy worm on a string.
That's right. Yeah.
So that kind of counts. So I'm gonna make that my honorable mention because it's only in the movie for about 4 seconds.
You might say that Spock can be kind of a puppet.
Why? Because he doesn't have emotions?
Saying. Yeah.
No. Okay. So my honorable mention was going to be Gremlins, but I'll switch that out for Star Trek II. My number three was the Muppet movie that came out in 11 with...
Jason Statham?
Yeah, not Jason Statham, but Jason... what's his name? Not Sudeikis. What's his name? He's from How I Met Your Mother. Gosh dang it.
Come on, Sam. You got this.
No, he doesn't.
No, I'm talking to you.
Oh, you're talking to me. Are you calling me Sam? It's not like I said, the guy from How I Met Your Mother, Barney Stinson. You know, come on.
Joe Pesci.
Yeah. Crap. Yeah. Did I just screw up the recording? Oh, shit.
What?
Hold on. Stop. Shit. I just. Oh, no, we're good. Gosh dang it. Okay.
Did you delete everything?
No. I don't
have to start the show over?
No, we're good. Start the show over. Gosh.
Oh my god.
No, it doesn't matter. Jason Segel.
Segel, yeah.
See? Segel, yeah. Anyway. So that's my number three. I like that movie. I think it's funny, especially when they do thanks, Sarah. My wife just sent me a text message from the bedroom with the appropriate name.
Nice.
I just like that the part in the movie where they're like, "Hey, we should travel by montage. That's too expensive. Let's just travel by map." Yes, travel by map. So anyway, Empire Strikes Back was my number two, and then The Muppets Christmas Carol was my number one.
Oh wow, Christmas Carol!
Okay. We watch it every year. We watch it on Christmas Eve every year, or at least we have since we were married, and. Yeah, it's a great one. I love it. Cool. That's our show. We're going to do an out of 10 now.
Oh, no.
No, yeah. Well, I guess I have to put a clip, don't I? Here we go. That's not it. We're going to play this.
Wait, what's supposed to happen?
That's right. This is where you guys tell me your score from 0 to 10. Andrew.
Well, there were some things that I did like, and I do appreciate the genius of the puppet makers at the time, because had they had the technology that we have today, when they made this movie would have been completely different. So for what they had to work with, and I think they did a great job. The only thing that did bother me was the voice acting, like Sam said at the beginning, bothered me quite a bit. And I just felt like the story was about 30 minutes too long for me. So I'm going to give it I'll just say 5. Just a solid 5 shards of crystal.
Okay.
And following up on Andrew, like I said, I've complained about this one quite a bit, both the sound, the story. But you can't complain about the visuals, right? I mean, there's something to them. So I've got to give them some sort of points for some pretty cool looking scenes. It's just that the direction wasn't all that great. So I don't want to watch it again. Although maybe if I did when I'm not on these pain meds, maybe it would be different. I don't know.
Would you watch this with your girls?
What's that?
Would you watch it with your girls, like Lucy? Like, would you watch
this? No, I don't think they'd want to. I don't think they'd like it.
Okay.
I don't think they'd like it. So I'd say 3.73 out of 10.
All right.
Not real good, in my mind.
I was trying to think if I would watch this with Declan. He's only 6. I probably wouldn't at 6, but maybe at like 8. You know, like a little older. Because we watched, I mean, he still gives me grief about Kubo and the Two Strings. I mean, that movie scared him. And he reminds me of it every time I'm flipping through Netflix and Kubo comes up. He goes, "Don't you dare stop on that one." I'm like, I won't, buddy. Because if you've seen it, it's a beautiful movie, and it's a really good movie. But there's two witches that are chasing the heroes throughout most of the movie, and they're wearing masks, so their faces don't move when they talk. And that just did it for him. It was the witches. Like, just them just scared him enough that he was like, "I don't ever want to watch that again." I said, "Okay, buddy, we won't. That's fine."
But wow.
Anyway, Scarring Children for Life. I love it. I like the movie. I have some nostalgia for it. Yeah, it's got some issues, but I think the creativity and the story is easy and simple, but it's still good. I think it's still a solid story plot line kind of a thing. So I'm going to give it a little bit of love, and I'm going to give it a 6.5 because I liked it. I thought it was fine. And yes, I know I'd put it above Buster Scruggs, but you know, eat me. I didn't much care for that. So there you go. So that's our movie. That's our show. That was fun. I was looking forward to it because, again, having not seen it in almost 30 years, you know, probably like 25 years, I wanted to kind of see if I remembered it and whatever. And
one good thing, too, was it was different. It was really different, which was kind of nice.
Yeah. I mean, after doing Ballad of Buster Scruggs, I wanted something kind of way different.
Yeah.
And so I got that. And then until next week, we're going to go somewhere else pretty different, I think. And I've changed the order up a little bit just because, again, last week we did Buster Scruggs, so we're not going to do True Grit next week.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to wait until after the September thing. So next week we're going to do Minority Report.
Ooh, okay.
That wasn't on the list.
A Spielberg flick.
Yeah, nice. It wasn't on the list. I saw that it was streaming. It's on Amazon Prime, not Netflix. It's on Amazon Prime.
Sweet.
But I saw it was streaming, and I haven't seen that movie in a while, and I remember really liking it.
I remember my eyes twitching when I remember this movie.
There is a lot of eye gore in this movie.
Yeah.
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 Weird.
It's pronounced Igor.
There was a lot of eye gore. Speaking of eye gore, literally in Rampage, the big ape kills the thing with the eye in the eye. And then in The Meg,
Jason. Spoiler alert.
The monkey kills somebody, whatever. And then the other one is there's another death. The Meg, he kills the Meg in the eye or something. It's like, my gosh, can we have any more eye gore going on right now? So, still working on the September. I know I tossed out the idea of doing a football or baseball themed movie month. And I threw it out on Twitter and Facebook, and literally the numbers are tied for the other. Like, Twitter says we want baseball, and Facebook says football or whatever the number it is. But I'm looking, and it might just be baseball and football because I can't find 4 good movies of each. So if you guys know of something that's out there streaming that I haven't seen yet, then you would think, oh, this would be a good movie to do for that genre. That streaming, you know, feel free to, you know, send us a Facebook message or Twitter or email, whatever, because I'd be all over that. Because right now I can only find really just a couple of good baseball and like 1 or 2 good football movies. So maybe we do 2 baseball and 2 football. I don't know. Yeah, because the 42 movie, the Jackie Robinson movie, looks really good, and Necessary Roughness is hilarious. So anyway, there you go. That's our show. That's our movie.
Awesome.
That's our thing. I'm going to hit this. And I'm going to come over here and say thank you guys so much for listening and being part of the show. You can check out us on cheapseatreviews.com. Once Sam gets back to work, he'll actually get that website going. It's only going to take him all semester to get caught up, but he will. Leave us a review on iTunes. Leave us a review on iTunes. Like us on Facebook, facebook.com/cheapseatreviews, and @cheapseatcast is our Twitter handle. And of course, you can send your emails to cheapseatreviews@gmail.com. I mean, you should, and you know, you should. If you want to, if you don't, that's fine, but you should. Like I said, we're doing Minority Report next week, and I'm looking forward to future stuff. Or not. I don't know. I can't remember. I just know that Tom Cruise runs a lot, and there's water. There's a lot of water in that movie for some reason. Like pools and floating things.
Tubs.
Yeah. Tubs. There's a lot of water in that movie. Anyway, I don't remember. Doesn't matter. So on behalf of Andrew and Sam, this is Sean saying thank you guys so much for listening. And I'm ending this thing way sooner than my audio clip is. So I'm trying to I've actually been doing this post show, but and I think that's probably the best way to do it is to do it post, because now I'm in this really awkward place where you're just hanging on listening to the show for no reason.
No, I think you're doing a great job. Just keep going.
Oh, this is this is awful this writing.
Just keep going. Yeah, you're doing it.
Made that podcast his bitch.
I mean, literally the only reason why I didn't just stop it because I wanted to play.
What's the great conjunction?
Conjunction, junction. What's your function?
I wanted to play that one more time. There you go.
And I'm glad you did. I feel my night is complete.
It is. And it'll also be stuck in your head for a little while, too.